بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، وبه نستعين على أمور الدنيا والدين، ولا عدوان إلا على الظالمين. My brothers and sisters, alhamdulillah, this is a great opportunity we have here with us, Sheikh Fahd Al-Fuhayd, and he will be going through the famous text, Kitab Al-Tawheed. This is an important text for all of us to learn. It is discussing the most important thing, which is the Tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is one of the main mashayikh in Riyadh. He's a professor in Aqeedah, and he will be benefiting us a lot, inshallah ta'ala. The class will be in Arabic, but it will be translated, inshallah ta'ala, by myself. So I hope this will become beneficial for all of us. And I thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for giving us this opportunity. And I thank the Shaykh for giving us his time and sharing with us his knowledge. طيب إن شاء الله شيخ سأبدأ بالقراءة المتن إن شاء الله. So we will be reading إن شاء الله تعالى the متن of كتاب التوحيد. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. قال المؤلف رحمه الله تعالى كتاب التوحيد وقول الله تعالى وما خلقت الجن والإنس إلا ليعبدون وقوله ولقد بعثنا في كل أمة رسولا أن يعبدوا الله واجتنبوا الطاغوت وقوله وقضى ربك ألا تعبدوا إلا إياه وبالوالدين إحسانا وقوله واعبدوا الله ولا تشركوا به شيئا وقوله قل تعالوا أتل ما حرم ربكم عليكم ألا تشركوا به شيئا. قال ابن مسعود رضي الله عنه من أراد أن ينظر إلى وصية محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم التي عليها خاتمه فليقرأ قوله تعالى قل تعالوا أتل ما حرم ربكم عليكم ألا تشركوا به شيئا وبالوالدين إحسانا إلى قوله وأن هذا صراطي مستقيما فاتبعوه ولا تتبعوا السبل. وعن معاذ بن جبل رضي الله عنه قال كنت رديف النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم على حمار فقال لي يا معاذ تدري ما حق الله على العباد وما حق العباد على الله؟ قلت الله ورسوله أعلم. قال حق الله على العباد أن يعبدوه ولا يشركوا به شيئا وحق العباد على الله ألا يعذب من لا يشرك به شيئا. قلت يا رسول الله أفلا أبشر الناس؟ قال لا تبشرهم فيتكلوا. أخرجاه في الصحيحين.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن اهتدى بهداه، أما بعد، حياكم الله أيها الإخوة الكرام في هذا المجلس من مجالس العلم، ونسأل الله سبحانه وتعالى أن ينفعنا بما نقول ونسمع، وأن يجعل ذلك في موازين حسناتنا، وأن يثبتنا وإياكم على الإسلام والسنة والتوحيد. أولا، هذا الكتاب كتاب التوحيد للشيخ محمد بن عبد الوهاب رحمه الله تعالى، المولود سنة 1500 والمتوفى سنة 1200 رحمه الله تعالى.
Alhamdulillah, the Shaykh started by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then he thanked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for giving us this opportunity of seeking knowledge and coming together to study this book. Then the Shaykh mentioned, may Allah preserve him, that this book is authored by Shaykh Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, which is a known scholar. May Allah have mercy on him. And the Shaykh mentioned his when he was born, which was the year 1015 Hijri, and when he died, which was the year 1062 Hijri, I believe. So may Allah have mercy on the Shaykh, and he will continue, inshallah ta'ala, with his explanation. Tafadhal, Shaykh.
وهذا الكتاب جمع فيه المؤلف رحمه الله الآيات التي في القرآن والأحاديث التي عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم، وأحيانا قليلة يذكر الآثار عن الصحابة، وأحيانا أقل وأقل يذكر بعض أقوال أهل العلم، ومجملها يدور على تحقيق التوحيد وإخلاص العبادة لله عز وجل، وهو لم يقصد أن يجمع كل الآيات وكل الأحاديث الواردة في هذا المعنى، وإنما أورد ما يدل على المقصود، فهو كتاب مفيد في هذا الباب جدا.
The Sheikh mentioned, may Allah preserve him, that this book is a compilation of ayat from the Quran, a hadith from the Prophet sallallahu wasallam alayhi, and sometimes he will mention the statements of the scholars and some of the athar of our beloved companions and the Salaf. Now, it is predominantly going to be ayat from the Quran and hadith from the Prophet, and less so the statements of the companions, and even less so the statements of the scholars to attach us to the Quran and Sunnah, of course. And similarly, the mawdu of this kitab or the subject matter is, of course, the Tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And not just the Tawheed of Allah, but establishing Tawheed and fulfilling it and having sincerity for Allah alone. Now, the Shaykh did not compile all the ahadith and all the ayat regarding this topic, but that which would be enough for us to understand it.
تفضل شيخ. والحاجة داعية إلى هذا الكتاب وأمثاله، فإن كثيرا من أحوال المسلمين تبدلت وتغيرت بسبب الجهل والخرافة وعلماء السوء والضلالة، فاحتاج أهل العلم أن يكتبوا ويذكروا الناس بما في كتاب الله وبما في سنة رسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم، بياناً للحق وأداءً للواجب ونصحاً للمسلمين.
And the Shaykh, may Allah preserve him, they mentioned the reason why this book was authored and similar books to it. And he said that there is a need for it, and the Ummah requires similar texts to be authored that focus on these subject matters, especially now with the increase of ignorance and with the increase of people calling towards that which is incorrect, and scholars that call towards that which is evil. So it is important that the scholars clarify to us what the truth is and to teach us the haqq. And this is why this book and others' book similar to it were authored. May Allah preserve our scholars.
وأول ضلال سجل أو رصد في التاريخ الإسلامي هو ناشئ عن أول ضلال في مسائل العبادة والإشراك بالله عز وجل هو ناشئ عن ضلال الرافضة وكذلك غلاة الصوفية، وكذلك سهل لهم وسوغ لهم ذلك علماء السوء من علماء الكلام وعلماء المتصوفة وكذلك غلاة المرجئة والجهمية، فهذه الضلالات إذا اجتمعت سببت للمسلمين لبسا وتخبيطا وصرفتهم عن عبادة الله جل وعلا وسهلت عليهم صرف العبادة لمن يسمونهم أولياء أو أئمة أو غيرهم.
The Shaykh mentioned, may Allah preserve him, again, the purpose behind these books and these lessons, and that the first deviation that happened within our Ummah, the Ummah of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, was the deviation with regards to worship that was brought about as a result of the Rafida and the Sufi, meaning the Sufis and the extreme Shia or the Rafida. Now, this was also because of the scholars that had evil intent, and they were calling towards things like Tasawwuf, and they were calling towards, and similarly, the Shaykh mentioned, people like the Murji'a and the Jahmiya, all deviant sects. Now, this caused confusion within the Muslim Ummah that must be rectified. And in fact, it is these sects and that have been calling towards that which is completely against Islam, such as the calling upon saints and making dua to them and even worshipping them. And because this was the first deviation that happened in our Ummah, it must be rectified through texts and lessons like these.
Alhamdulillah, أن الله سبحانه وتعالى حفظ كتابه وسنة نبيه صلى الله عليه وسلم. فمن أراد أن يعرف الإسلام الصافي الخالص من الشوائب والبدع فليرجع إلى كتاب الله وإلى سنة رسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم وإلى كلام الصحابة والتابعين. وهذا ما قصده الشيخ محمد ابن عبد الوهاب في تأليف هذا الكتاب، وسننظر في الأدلة بعد قليل وفي الأبواب التي ستأتي، كلها تبين لك سماحة الإسلام وصفاء الإسلام ونقاوة الإسلام من ما أحدثه المبتدعة والمشركون.
The Shaykh praised Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and mentioned that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has preserved his book, the Quran, and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Revelation is preserved. And whoever wants to find the truth and the correct Islam, then the Islam that is free from innovation, that is free from shirk and its like, then he should stick with the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but also with the statements of the companions and the tabi'een, meaning the Salaf al-Salih. Now, inshallah ta'ala, the Shaykh said that the author of this book, Shaykh Muhammad Abdul Wahhab, Allah preserves with him, in this book, he did just that. He compiled it, the ayat, the ahadith, and the statements of the companions. And the Shaykh will say, he said that we will look, inshallah ta'ala, into these verses and in these statements of the scholars that the Shaykh has compiled shortly and discuss some of the chapters in this book.
والتوحيد في لغة العرب هو مصدر لقولك وحد يوحد. وحد هذا فعل الماضي، يوحد فعل مضارع، المصدر توحيدا. فالتوحيد هو مصدر لهذا الفعل وحد. وحد يعني أفرد. وإذا قلت وحد الله أي أفرد الله عز وجل بماذا؟ أي أفرد الله عز وجل بما يستحقه، أفرد الله عز وجل بما يستحقه، أي جعل الله واحدا فيما يستحقه. ما الذي يستحقه سبحانه وتعالى؟ أن يكون هو الرب وحده لا شريك له، وأن يكون هو المعبود وحده لا شريك له، وأن تكون له الأسماء الحسنى والصفات العلى لا مثيل له ولا ند له. فالتوحيد هو إفراد الله بالعبادة، وهذا توحيد الألوهية، وإفراد الله بالربوبية، وهذا توحيد الربوبية، وإفراد الله بالأسماء والصفات، وهذا توحيد الأسماء والصفات.
The Shaykh, may Allah preserve him, now spoke about the definition of Tawheed, because the book that we are studying is Kitab al-Tawheed. And the Shaykh said that the word Tawheed is derived from the root word Wahada Yuwahidu, meaning to make something one, to make something one. This is why we use this term, because we single out Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we make Allah one in regards to the one who, the only one deserving of worship, in regards to the only one who is our Rabb, our Lord, and we figure him out in his beautiful names and attributes. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the only Lord, the only one worthy of worship, the only one with these perfect and beautiful names and attributes. And the Shaykh said that the definition of Tawheed, which is very important, of course, is إفرادullah بالعبادة وإفرادullah بالربوبية وإفرادullah بالأسماء وصفات, meaning to single out Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in all acts of worship, to single out Allah in his lordship, and to single out Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in his beautiful names and attributes. نعم شيخ.
وهذا المعنى قد يعبر عنه بعض العلماء بأن التوحيد نوعان: توحيد علمي خبري، وتوحيد عملي طلبي أو قصد، توحيد القصد والإرادة. فالأول العلمي الخبري هو توحيد الربوبية والأسماء والصفات، والثاني توحيد عملي أو توحيد القصد والإرادة والطلب هو توحيد الألوهية والعبادة.
Now the Shaykh, may Allah preserve him, mentioned that now that we know what Tawheed means or the definition, it can also be categorized into two. That is Tawheed al-ilmi, al-khabari, and Tawheed al-amali, or al-talab, or al-qasr. Meaning, that tawheed is either that which you single out Allah in that which we know about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So what is it that we know about Allah? We know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, His lordship, He's the Rabb. And similarly, we know of His beautiful names and attributes. So this is with regards to who Allah is. And so the tawheed that talks about who Allah is, and we get khabar, information or knowledge from, this is one aspect of tawheed. And that is Allah's lordship and Allah's beautiful names and attributes. And then there is a tawheed that's regarding our actions. And that is when we call tawheed al-amali, the tawheed with regards to your actions. So you single out Allah in your prayer and in your actions. It is also known as tawheed al-talab wal-qasd, meaning this is the tawheed that you must do, that is required from you to do, unless you are actually involved in. Whereas with regards to knowing who Allah is, with the rububiyyah and asma wa sifat, this is more about getting to know who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is and singling Him out in who He is and what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does. So that's another categorization of tawheed. Na'am Shaykh.
Tawheed al-ibadah, or tawheed al-uluhiyyah, idha aqarra bihi al-abd, fa'innahu يتضمن ذلك إقراره بالربوبية وبالأسماء والصفات ولا شك. أما إذا أقر بتوحيد الربوبية فقد يفرد الله بالعبادة ويعبده، وقد لا يعبده، وقد يشرك معه غيره. ولهذا العلماء يعبرون عن هذه المعاني بقولهم توحيد الألوهية يتضمن الربوبية والأسماء والصفات، أما توحيد الربوبية فإنه يستلزم توحيد الألوهية ولا يتضمنه، وسأشرح هذا بعد قليل.
The Shaykh, may Allah preserve him now, spoke about some of the differences between توحيد الألوهية and توحيد الربوبية, and he mentions that to single out Allah in our actions and worship, and to only worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to believe this, when the Muslim believes this, this automatically includes the other aspects of tawheed like the rububiyyah and al-asma wa sifat. But the opposite is not the case. So if one acknowledges that Allah exists, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is His Lord and His Creator, and admits to tawheed al-rububiyyah, that doesn't necessitate that they will worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the Shaykh gave a principle, which is that the Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah yatadamman al-Rububiyyah wal asma' wa sifat, meaning that the Tawheed with regards to our actions, single out Allah and worship, includes the other two Tawheeds as well, whereas just Tawheed al-Rububiyyah, it does not include the worship of Allah or singling out in worship, but it is something that would lead to it or should lead to it. Na'am Shaykh.
فعلى سبيل المثال مشركو قريش الذين كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يدعوهم إلى الإسلام وإلى التوحيد وللإيمان، كانوا يعترفون بأن الله هو الخالق كما ذكر الله هذا في مواضع كثيرة، ولئن سألتهم من خلقهم لا يقولون الله، ولكنهم يشركون معه غيره. فلما دعاهم إلى إفراده بالعبادة أبوا وقالوا أجعل الآلهة إلها واحدة إن هذا لشيء عجاب. فقولهم أجعل الآلهة، لأنهم كانوا يعبدون معبودات كثيرة، فاستنكروا أن يكون المعبود واحدا، مع أنهم يعترفون ويقرون بأن الرب الخالق واحد كما ذكر في هذه الآيات، وسأذكر أمثلة أخرى بعد الترجمة.
The Shaykh now mentioned or gave an example of what he explained earlier with regards to the one who believes in Allah's rububiyyah. It doesn't necessitate that they will single him out in worship. And the example he gave is of the mushrikeen of Quraysh, the polytheists during the Prophet's time. And they admitted that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the creator. So the kuffar of Quraysh admitted this, and Allah mentions this in the Quran, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَئِنْ سَأَلْتَهُمْ مَنْ خَلَقَهُمْ لَيَقُولُنَ اللَّهُ. When, O Muhammad, when you ask them who created you, they will say Allah. But although they admitted that Allah was their creator and their Lord, yet they refused to single out Allah in worship. And this is why they said, أَجْعَلْ الْآلِهَةَ إِلَهًا وَاحِدٍ. Have you made, O Muhammad, that which we worship just one God? So they did this because they didn't agree with this. And they said, we don't agree with this. They had many things that they worshipped, many idols that they worshipped. And this is where the problem lies. So just admitting that Allah is the creator and just believing in the rububiyyah, in Allah's lordship, is not enough. You must also single him out in worship.
وأيضا على سبيل المثال قصة قوم ثمود مع نبي الله صالح، فإن نبي الله صالح عليه السلام حكى الله عز وجل قوله لهم أول ما بدأ به أن قال لهم اعبدوا الله ما لكم من إله غيره، وهكذا كل نبي. لكن في هذه القصة برهان ساطع على أنهم يقرون بالربوبية، حيث قال الله عز وجل في سورة النمل عنهم قالوا تقاسموا بالله لنبيتنه وأهله ثم لنقولن لوليه ما شهدنا مهلك أهله وإنا لصادقون. الشاهد قالوا تقاسموا بالله، يعني أقسموا بالله حتى يقتنع الناس، أقسموا بالله أنكم ما فعلتم كذا وكذا. إذن هم يعرفون الله ويقرون بأنه عظيم ويقسم به، فهذا يبين لك أنهم أشركوا في العبادة، ولهذا قال لهم نبيهم اعبدوا الله ما لكم من إله غيره. بالتالي نصل إلى النتيجة دلائلها لا تحصى وأمثلتها لا يمكن أن تستقصى، وهي أن الإقرار بالربوبية فقط لا يكفي، بل يجب أن يضاف إلى ذلك إفراد الله بالعبادة. أفعال العبد لا تتوجه قلبه وجوارحه ولسانه لا يتوجه ولا يتعبد ولا يتأله إلا إلى الله سبحانه وتعالى.
الشيخ may Allah preserve him gave another example, and this example is with the people of Thamud, and those were the people of Prophet Salih عليه السلام. And he says in the story of Prophet Salih with his people is evidence and a proof and a dalil that they actually did acknowledge Allah's existence and they believed in Allah. And that the problem that they had was that they refused to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah mentions in Surah An-Naml where they said, قَالُوا تَقَاسَمُوا بِاللَّهِ لَنَبَيِّتَنَّهِ, that they swore by Allah. They were plotting and a plan to harm the Prophet عليه السلام. But Allah, the point of reference here in this verse, or the mahallu shahid, is taqasamu billah. They swore by Allah, meaning they did believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So what was the problem? The problem was they refused to single him out in worship. They were polytheists. They were worshipping other gods besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So what do we conclude from this and from the people of Quraysh? We conclude the following, that just al-iqrar bil-rububiyyah, just by believing in Allah's lordship, that Allah created us, that He exists, etc., is absolutely not enough for one to be considered a believer, a Muslim. You must single out Allah in all types of worship, and whether that worship is from your heart, from your tongue, your speech, whether it is the actions that you do from your limbs, every single action that you do in devotion and in worship should be directed only and solely to Allah Jalla Jalaluhu.
أطلت في هذه المسألة قليلا لأن الخرافيين اليوم من ظلال الصوفية وبعض المبتدعة يحاولون أن يشوشوا على أهل السنة وعلى عموم المسلمين، فيقولون لا فرق بين الربوبية والألوهية، وهذا مخالف للقرآن ومخالف للسنة ومخالف للفطرة، حتى العقل يأبى ذلك. فإن الألوهية هي عبادات العبد يصرفها لله، والربوبية هي اعتقاداته، فيعتقد أن الله هو الكامل ولا شريك له. فيلبس هؤلاء الصوفية الآن وينشطون في التشويش على المسلمين في هذه القضية الواضحة في كتاب الله، عليكم أن تحذروا منهم.
Sheikh that mentioned that even though this fact is as clear as the sun, that there is a clear difference between the Rububiyya and the Uluhiyya, that there are people, and they are the extreme Sufis and their like, and the innovators, that will try and claim there is no difference between the Ar-Rububiyya and the Uluhiyya. And because of this, they will deviate the people. And there is a clear difference between these two and those that claim there is no difference. This goes against the Quran, this goes against the Sunnah, this goes against the sound intellect, and this is a way to confuse the people and to deviate the people. Now, how does it go against the sound intellect even? Because, and the Quran and Sunnah, because Tawheed al-Uluhiyya, to single out Allah in worship, means what? It means that you, your actions, your prayer, and what you do should be only done for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Tawheed al-Rububiyya is regarding Allah. We single out Allah in what we know about Him, that He is the only creator, that He is the only sustainer. So there's a clear difference that you can ascertain from the Quran, from the Sunnah, and from the sound intellect.
نبدأ الآن بقراءة في الكتاب. يقول الشيخ: كتاب التوحيد وقول الله تعالى: وما خلقت الجن والإنس إلا ليعبدون. هذه الآية في سورة الذاريات يبين الله سبحانه وتعالى فيها الحكمة من خلق الجن والإنس، وهي إلا ليعبدون، أي ليوحدون، أي يفردون الله بالعبادة. وهذا فيه فائدة أو فوائد أخرى، منها أن إفراد الله بالعبادة هو الغاية من خلق الجن والإنس، فإذا حققوها فازوا وسعدوا، وإذا أعرضوا عنها هلكوا وعذبوا.
The Shaykh now started to actually explain the matan, and he said that the first verse that Shaykh Abdullah mentions is وَمَا خَلَقْتُمْ جِنَّا وَالْإِنِسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. We have not created jinn nor mankind except to worship me, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, except to single me out and worship. And from this we learn the wisdom behind the creation of the jinn and the ins, the hikmah. And that wisdom is to single out Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in worship. And this is the reason why we exist. This is what we should be doing. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created us.
أيضا في الآية نفي وإثبات، لأن التوحيد لا بد فيه من نفي وإثبات. فنفى أن يكون خلق الجن والإنس لغير هذه الحكمة، وهي عبادة الله سبحانه وتعالى. وأيضا في هذه الآية قال ليعبدون ولم يقل ليعرفون، فإن معرفة الله هذا توحيد الربوبية، أما عبادة الله فهو توحيد الألوهية، ومن عبد الله وأخلص له العبادة فإنه أتى بالألوهية وأتى بالربوبية، أما من عرف الله فقد يعبده وقد لا يعبده وقد يشرك معه غيره. نعم.
Another benefit from this particular verse is that in it is a nafi and ithbat, meaning a negation and an affirmation. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not create us except to single Him out in worship. And He also mentioned that there is a benefit in this verse, which is, why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say liya'budun? And He did not say liya'rifun, because there's a difference between worship and knowing who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is. The one who singles out Allah in worship, no doubt that he also knows who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is. So whoever worships Allah surely has done both. He has done all forms of tawheed based on his worship. You only worship the one you know. Now, if the requirement here would be just to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then if you know Allah, it doesn't necessitate that you worship Him. For you could know Allah and refuse to worship Him. Or you could know Allah and worship others besides Him. This is why the concept of ibadah is far more pertinent and important, because it highlights just knowing Allah is not enough. You must also single Him out in worship.
الآية الثانية قول الله عز وجل: وَلَقَدْ بَعَثْنَا فِي كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ رَسُولًا أَنْ يَعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ وَاجْتَنِبُوا الطَّاغُوتِ. هذه الآية تبين خلاصة دعوة جميع الرسل، وهي اعبدوا الله واجتنبوا الطاغوت. أن هنا في الآية أن يعبدوا أن هنا سمى عند العلماء التفسيرية، أي تفسر ما قبلها. ماذا ما الذي قبلها؟ بعثنا في كل أمة رسولا، يعني ماذا يقول لهم؟ ما رسالته؟ جاء التفسير أن اعبدوا الله واجتنبوا الطاغوت. ولاحظ النفي والإثبات، اعبدوا الله إثبات، واجتنبوا الطاغوت نفي، والطاغوت كل ما عبد من دون الله عز وجل.
The Shaykh starts explaining, may Allah preserve him, the second verse that is mentioned in the book, in the chapter, which is وَلَقَدْ بَعَثْنَا فِي كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ رَسُولًا أَنْ اعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ وَاجْتَنِبُوا الطَّاغُوتَ. And indeed we have not sent we have sent a messenger to every nation to call towards the singling out of Allah in worship and to stay away or leave off طاغوت. Now the Shaykh then started explaining the أَنِعْبُدُ اللَّهَ bit, and he said that أَنِعْبُدُ اللَّهَ, the N, the Alif and Noon there, it has a meaning, and that means it explains. It is tafsiriya, meaning this N will explain the reason for the ba'ath. So Allah says, indeed we have sent. So why did Allah send the messenger? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent them so that Allah only will be worshipped. So to single out Allah in worship, just that, no, but also to leave off taghut. And what is taghut? Taghut is everything that is worshipped beside Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, another benefit in this verse is that there is a negation and affirmation. This is very important. We affirm that only Allah should be worshipped. We negate the worship of other false gods. And this is why we stay away from taghut. To worship Allah and to stay away from taghut. And taghut is that which is worshipped besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
وفي الآية دليل على رحمة الله بأهل الأرض، وأنه لا توجد أمة من أمم الأرض إلا وأرسل إليهم رسولا، منهم من سماه الله لنا ومنهم من لا نعلمه، فجميع أمم الأرض أرسل إليهم رسل، كل أمة. أيضا الرسل طريقتهم واحدة، دينهم واحد، اعبدوا الله واجتنبوا الطاغوت.
The Shaykh mentioned, hafidhahullah, that there is another benefit in this verse, and that is that it shows the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon the people. For there is not a nation except Allah sent them a messenger. There's not a nation except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent them a messenger. And we might know about these nations, and there are many of them that are told to us in the Quran, and some of them, of course, we do not know about. But every nation Allah sent a messenger. Another benefit we see here is that the message of all of these messengers was one, and that was to call towards the Tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Every messenger had the same general message, to call towards the worship of Allah alone.
وفي الآية دليل على أن من آمن بالطاغوت فإنه لا يمكن أن يعبد الله، لا يجتمع هذا مع هذا، فلا بد من النفي والإثبات، وهذا معنى قول المسلم لا إله إلا الله، وهذا معنى قول الله تعالى فمن يكفر بالطاغوت ويؤمن بالله فقد استمسك بالعروة الوثقى. نعم.
There is a evidence in this verse, a dalil, that whoever so believes in the worship of false deities, that he then cannot claim, and it is impossible for that person to say they worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The two cannot be combined. You either single Allah in worship, or you fall into the worship of others. This is the meaning of La ilaha illallah. It must have an affirmation and a negation. You must affirm that you only worship Allah, and that you deny the worship of all other gods beside Allah Jalla Jalaluhu. And the Shaykh then mentioned another verse, وَنْ يَكْفُرُ بِالطَّاغُوتِ وَيُؤْمِنْ بِاللَّهِ. Whoever leaves off, whoever denounces the worship of Taghut and believes in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, these two cannot be combined. It is one or the other. This is why there is always that which we negate, the worship of false gods, and that which we affirm, the singling of Allah in worship.
الآية الثالثة والرابعة والخامسة، هذه الآيات في الأوامر والنواهي. أولها قوله تعالى وقضى ربك ألا تعبدوا إلا إياه وبالوالدين إحسانا، والآية اللي بعدها واعبدوا الله ولا تشركوا به شيئا، تسمى آية الحقوق العشرة، والثالثة في سورة الأنعام. إذن أول آية في الحكمة من الخلق، ثاني آية في الحكمة من إرسال الرسل، ثالث آية في الحكمة من جميع الأوامر والنواهي، وهي إفراد الله بالعبادة والبراءة من الشرك. نعم.
The Shaykh then starts explaining the following three verses. And he said that these three following verses, وَقَدَى رَبُّكَ لَا تَعْبُدُ إِلَّا إِيَّهِ and the following two, they are the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the prohibitions. And this is what they teach and highlight. The first one, Allah commands that he should be singled out in worship and the dutifulness to parents. The second one, Allah commands that he should be singled out in worship and no partners associated with him. And finally, in the final verse in Surah An'am, a similar where Allah prohibited the worship of other gods besides him. So, and the second verse, it is also known as the 10 rights. It mentions 10 rights. And the first one, of course, is the right of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be singled out in worship. Another benefit here that you see with the author of the book, Shaykh Muhammad al-Wahhab, he mentioned the first verse and that the wisdom behind the creation. And the second verse, the wisdom behind the ba'athing, or the descending of the messengers. And finally, the Shaykh mentioned the three other verses. They show us the wisdom behind all commandments and all prohibitions falls down to worship Allah alone and leave off the worship of other gods besides him.
نعم. ولو تأملتم الأوامر والنواهي لوجدتم أن الله عز وجل بدأ بالأمر بعبادته والنهي عن الإشراك به، ثم يذكر بقية الأوامر والنواهي، وهذا يبين لك عظم التوحيد وأنه مقدم على جميع الفرائض، وأنه أوجب الواجبات وأعظم الفروض، وأن الشرك بالله أعظم الذنوب. نعم.
Another benefit you find from these verses is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will always start by talking about the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the avoiding of shirk. And then subsequently, Allah speaks about other commandments that are in the verse. So the other wajibat of the Muslim, other things you must do. So why does always Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala start by his tawheed? And why does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala always start with the avoiding of shirk before mentioning all the other muharramat, all the other prohibited things? This is because it shows you the importance and the greatness of these matters. There's nothing greater that one can do except the tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There's nothing worse one can do except shirk. So the fact that Allah starts with them before mentioning the other shows that they are far greater in importance.
أيضا كلام عبد الله بن مسعود الصحابي الجليل يدل على أن الصحابة عرفوا أهمية هذا الأمر ويؤكدون عليه، كما في الأثر الذي قرأته قبل قليل: من أراد أن ينظر إلى وصية محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم التي عليها خاتمه فليقرأ هذه الآيات الثلاث. وهذا يدل على اهتمام الصحابة والسلف بهذه الآيات.
And from the athar or the statement of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, where he said regarding the verse mentioned earlier, whoever wants to see the advice or the everlasting advice, the wasiyya of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, that has his stamp of approval, if you will, then let him recite these verses. It shows you how they regarded these matters as extremely important and how they spoke about these matters, especially with regards to Tawheed.
أيضا حديث معاذ بن جبل رضي الله عنه أنه كان رديف النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم على حمار، وهذا يدل على تواضع النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. وفيه هذا السؤال العظيم: ما حق الله على العباد؟ وأجابه النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بأن حق الله أن يعبدوه ولا يشركوا به شيئا، لم يقل أن يعرفوه، إنما قال أن يعبدوه، والعبادة هي حق الله. ولهذا هناك فرق بين توحيد العبادة والألوهية وبين توحيد الربوبية. وفي هذا الحديث فضل أهل التوحيد، وهو أنهم موعودون بأن لا يعذبهم الله عز وجل، وهذا يدل على كمال التوحيد وشرفه.
The Shaykh then mentioned the hadith that is mentioned here of Mu'ad ibn Jabal, where Mu'ad ibn Jabal was with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they were riding a donkey together, or a mule together. And then the Prophet asks Mu'ad, do you know what the rights of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are? And then also the rights of his servants. And then he mentions that only Allah and his messenger know. And then the Prophet told him that the right of Allah is to be singled out in worship and to not commit any shirk. And then the rights of the people is that they will not be punished. So from this, we benefit a few things. Number one, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and how humble he was, that he was riding a mule. And this shows the humbleness of our messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It also shows the importance of Tawheed and how the right of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is to single him out in worship, not just to know him. And this is an important distinction because it refers back to what we spoke earlier, that the Rububiyyah and Uluhiyyah, that it is Uluhiyyah that is what is being referred to here. We need to worship Allah and not just worship him, but worship him alone, subhanahu wa ta'ala. These are some of the benefits of this hadith.
وفي الحديث أنه لا ينبغي للموحد المسلم الموحد لا يتكل على التوحيد فيترك العمل ويترك الاجتهاد والأعمال الصالحات، بل بالعكس التوحيد يقوي العمل الصالح ويشجع المؤمن على إخلاص العبادة لله والتوجه إليه سبحانه وتعالى.
And the Sheikh said that another benefit in the hadith is, so the hadith continues after the Prophet taught Mu'ad about the rights of Allah, meaning the ultimate right of Allah, which is to worship him alone and to not commit any shirk. This is Allah's ultimate right. Then he said the people's right is that if they do that, they will not be punished. So of course, this is a glad tidings for the believers, that if they single out Allah in his ibadah, then they will not be punished. But when Mu'ad asked the Prophet ﷺ, do I not then give this glad tidings to the people and tell everyone, then the Prophet ﷺ said, no, do not tell everyone and give them the glad tidings that as long as you have tawheed, you will not be punished, because they will only rely on it. فَيَتَّكِلُ, meaning don't say it to them, because they will rely on this solely. And what they need to do is they need to strengthen their tawheed with the good deeds that they're doing. And tawheed should encourage them to do more good, not for them to just relax and rely on the fact that they are saying la ilaha illallah. That should not be the case. And this is why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that beware that, so that they do not just rely on this glad tiding, but for sure it is a glad tiding for the believers.
هذا وبالله التوفيق وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وجزاكم الله خيرا والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
جزاك الله خير. The Sheikh concluded the lesson here. May Allah preserve him and put all of his good deeds on the scales of good the day of judgment. Sheikh, جزاك الله خيرا على هذه الفوائد. بارك الله فيك وأحسن الله إليك. And we are stopping the lesson here, inshallah ta'ala. Please stay tuned for next week. هذا وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين.